Wait, why are you going to have a sign?
That's just a copy.
What's happening in LA?
Yeah, no, it's a good thing and it's the right time.
Yeah.
Let's go.
Hello, everybody. Ding, ding, hi, guys. Hello. Welcome to the Numbers. I'm Todd Wellner. For those of you who don't know me, we are the director here. And I could say at this point a friend of TDF.
I would say so.
That's the Friends of TDF squad over there. The sing along. I just want to thank you, everybody, for coming to this. This is a really, it's an important project that they're doing along with Theater Bay Area. Ray Erickson's here. I feel it particularly because I did work with TDF along with them, because he was back there for something like 5 years.
At least. Almost as long as it took to build the booth.
Right. Felt like a lifetime. With the project that he came out with, his fortune. And one of the things that we discovered almost immediately after that report came out, is that though underlying conditions and perceptions take a long time to change, that actually practices change very quickly. That there's often a lot of alteration, change, mutation in the field, and I believe it's regularly not seen because our perceptions are so fixed that we don't notice the changes that are happening around us. So one of the great things about this project is building on, and they'll tell you all about it, but building on outrageous fortune on the one hand, and TBA's continuity beings on the other, they're really both digging deeper and moving forward to find out more about what we meant and what this study of intrinsic impact and audience is meant. So it's a really important thing. We're thrilled to have Tori Bailey, Brad Erickson, and Mark Blankenship here with us, and they're going to tell you everything that helps, because I ran out of my knowledge.
Thanks for coming, guys. Thank you all for joining us. As Todd said, and I'm reminding you that we're live streaming. And so we were asked by some folks, got a note that to make sure, we're on HowlRound, and to make sure that when you guys talk that you, as Brad says, use your active voice, because they want to make sure that they can hear you as well. As Todd said, this really came out of the two pieces of work that our two service organizations did. Both of our service organizations are committed in large part to strengthening and building audiences and supporting the theater by doing that, although Brad, unlike TDF, also has producers and artists as members. And the two of us were at the famous From Scarcity to Abundance convening with some of the rest of you in the District of Columbia when Rocco gave the famous speech about it wasn't that the scarcity made his scarcity in abundance remarks, and Brad and I at the time looked at each other and went, we're not doing our jobs, because the problem isn't that there are too many theaters, the problem is there aren't enough people engaging with those theaters, and that's kind of what we're supposed to do. And at the end of that weekend, there was a breakout session or a session in which people kept talking about the audience, and a playwright, and I confess I don't remember who it was, said, why do we always talk about the audience and we never put them in the room? And so this is an effort to really, this project funded in large part by the Doris Duke Charitable Trust, to whom we owe a thank you, a big thank you. This project is really a way to start to look at, as we said in the email, not just, you know, intrinsic impact looks at audiences and theaters, and in Outrageous Fortune we looked at theaters and playwrights, and we actually don't look at those things in a circle. And then it really comes out of a desire for us to put our minds together, A, highlighting best practices, B, all of you who are here are doing really interesting stuff with your audiences and with your artists, or you are artists who we've interacted with over the years who care about this stuff. We also have a few marketing directors here, which I'm really pleased about, because this is also a conversation about marketing, and this is a conversation about how we interact in those parts. And I don't know if you want to talk at all more about intrinsic impact and where that relates.
Yeah, and just a little bit more, really wasn't that arena convening where I think really was the birthplace of this idea. And for me, a breakout session that I was in, there was someone who was a presenter, a large presenting organization, who said, you know, what we bring is to this process, we bring the audience. And I thought, wow, what a really cool idea. And couple moments after that, someone said, you know, it's interesting because you would think that the institutions should be the bridge between the artist and the audience, but too often, inadvertently, and that might be me adding that, they're acting like a wall instead of like a bridge. And how, and like, well, what was that? And how can theater organizations actually act as someone said at Woolley a couple weeks ago, as a platform for bringing together, literally bringing together the artist and the audience, and what would that look like? So that's part of what these conversations are about, is really trying to understand what we're calling a triangular relationship between the artist, the audience, and the theater organization that hopefully is bringing them together in some way.
So what it looks like is we did the commission brief, small research, which we shared with you, this is the third of six cities that we're having conversations around the country, talking to people and getting their perceptions and reactions. We are going to do, this summer, we're going to commission another piece of research which will really talk directly to audiences. And one of the things we're trying to do is build a community and hope that we can get you guys engaged so that then when the time comes, you might actually help us disseminate that survey. So one of the things that we're trying to tease out today are, if you could actually talk to folks about this stuff, what would you want to learn? What would you want to know? And again, to Todd's point, this is about practical considerations. It was something that surfaced a bunch when we were in San Francisco, was a theater that, for instance, is worried that if they send their folks to other theaters, and there's a kind of cross, and they, you know, if an artist works one place and then another, and so you would want to move to that place with them, well, then they might lose them as a donor. I thought that's interesting, right? What is that about with an audience and people give stuff like that? Before we start, because Brad is visiting us from the other coast, he thought it looked really pretty this morning.
Snowing! Like, ooh!
It's like, you are so not to say that. But because he's visiting, I thought it would just be really helpful if people, I know all of you, but you don't. So if you guys could just introduce yourselves. Starting with Todd.
I'm Todd. One artistic director.
Hi, I'm Liz Stephanie. I'm a playwright, ex-new dramatist, old dramatist. I'm Emily Morrison, the director of artistic development.
Lou Moreno, artistic director of Intar Theater.
Susan Burnfield, producing artistic director of New Georges.
Kristen Martin, artistic director of Here.
Damon Tron, a playwright, currently working with Pan Asian Rep.
Tisa Chang, founding artistic director of Pan Asian Repertory.
Maria Stryer, producing artistic director of Club Fun.
John Diaz, artistic director of Two Rivers Theater Company.
Kristen Parker, I'm the associate artistic director at Atlanta Theater Company.
Jeremy Walker, I'm the managing director at New York Theater Workshop.
Mandy Greenfield, I'm the artistic producer at the Manhattan Theater Club. What do you want?
Ben Hesner, co-author of TDF's Outrageous Fortune and program director of Venturous Theater Fund.
I'm Tom O'Connor, I'm the Director of Marketing and Audience Development at Roundtable.
I'm Eric Winnick, I'm the Director of Marketing at Theatremakers.
I'm Cheryl Fishman, I'm the General Manager of Theatremakers.
And all three of you are banded together, but I promise. It's really a fine conversation. Carol's got your back.
I could just hear us talking.
And you should introduce yourself.
And my name's Mark Blankenship. I know some of you. I am the editor of TDF Stage's Theater Development Fund's online magazine and the producer of Meet the Theater, a series of short films about interesting theater companies here in New York City.
And over there, please.
Hi, I'm Erin Winchester, and I'm the assistant to the executive director at TDF.
And she's been emailing all of you.
I'm Connie Hall, the manager of institutional giving at TDF.
Mike Nauman, I'm the managing director at TDF. I'm the director of education at TDF.
Kostas Megalopoulos, I'm the IT person at TDF.
And I'll just share with all of you that we have a gala on Monday, so I'm a little nervous that so many people are here, but that's okay. So let's get started. It's really scary, but it's really okay.
This is Wednesday already, right?
Uh-huh. We need to sell about 50 more tickets. If anybody, anyway, so thoughts, first reactions. I mean, we had two very different kinds of research, one of which was really Zani's work, and we're still executive summary yet to come, but really was looking at the theaters and playwrights and how they talked, how they thought about kind of parallel questions. Mm-hmm. Alan's work is really looking at risk. As I think I said in the email, we're moving beyond playwrights. We're also thinking about directors. We're thinking about, right, who's the artist and how they talk to the audience, how they're involved in their work. And then with risk, you know, it's pretty clear new plays are sometimes really risky, and sometimes new plays are about not the least bit risky, and sometimes classics, right, totally risky. So to think a little bit, just kind of what were some of your thoughts and responses, or as you read stuff, what resonated, what didn't seem true? Yes?
I actually underlined that some new work, for instance, has no risk attached. That was in your email. And I wondered, what new work has no risk attached? I actually wondered what was the underlying assumption that something that is new, when we're creating something from nothing, mm-hmm. when is it perceived that there's no risk?
What do you think?
When it's new work.
Yeah. Well, yeah, I was going to say it doesn't have to be
exactly.
Yeah. There was something in the study, right, that said, that talked about the audience members' approach to any experience as being inherently risky. And you know, you don't know what a production is going to be like until you've sat through it, which doesn't, I think, doesn't matter if it's new or if it's a reinterpretation, or even if it's just a production of a classic that isn't reinterpreted.
Talk a little bit about what you see as risk. What does the audience perceive as risk? Yeah.
Probably a fairly new playwright whose name is not as recognizable as, let's say, what we put. Many we know, and theme, content. I think obviously if there's something that is a traditional format, say comedies, mm-hmm. say, romantic comedy, that might be perceived to be safer than certain. So I think content and certainly the playwright's name.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
The triple whammy of the new playwright, unknown playwright, with no marquee names in the cast.
Our
specialty. Is
that so? I was going to say risk is an equation more than just a factor. Yeah. It's an equation of all the different levels at which you produce, whether that's the content, whether that's the task. And I think we have a tendency to try to zone in on one, but it really is a mixture of all three.
That was I was having a similar response too, because I thought maybe what I'm learning about my theory is not really helpful to this, but we just did a production of As You Like It, which didn't come close to making our goals. That was a huge risk for us to do Shakespeare. I find that astonishing, but it happened to be true.
Did you know ahead of time that it was?
Well, a little bit, just anecdotally hearing people talk about being afraid of Shakespeare. So, okay. But what was interesting, one of the very first things, I've only been at the theater for 3 years, one of the very first things in my program this season was to put in a new play that we had been developing by a completely unknown writer, with real fear of the risk of doing that. And it was astonishing. It was one of our best-selling things in the season. So it's...
And why do you have any idea about why it worked that way?
Looking at some of those statistics that you guys have done, I just thought, it so depends on who you're talking to. It's so about individuals. Like, what is an appetite for risk, and a sense of adventure? And we depend a lot on our subscribers. And there was one thing that you guys found in here that I found true too, which is subscribers are generally more likely to take risk on things, is what I'm finding. That was surprising to me. Our subscribers were a lot of cool people. We didn't think they would sign up in the year that we programmed this new play, that it was the first time the theater had done a new play in a subscription. We just didn't think people would sign up, but they overwhelmingly signed up. It was all the subscribers that we signed up to.
So you offered it to them that wasn't part of the subscription series?
It was, but it was the first year that the theater had ever put a new play in a subscription.
Oh, I see.
And just to piggyback on about names that are not familiar to American audiences, because Panners and Repertory Theater, of course, as our name implies, we produce many playwrights from the international community, mm-hmm. and Damon is from Singapore originally, In 2012, we had a new first-time South Asian playwright, Mayan Keshavia. So names like that, I'm saying, unrecognizable, unfamiliar names. Sometimes the sense is, do you perform in English, one, and the other is, what is the theme about? So I think for us, we sort of have a double whammy, because we're trying to introduce these very exotic names and themes to the American audiences.
Done?
You know, I was really struck, and I don't have enough from me, and I may be misremembering it, but that how much this notion of both perception and context affects. Mm. I mean, I actually find that analysis, that the specificity of the breakdown of the risk and what it means really provocative. And I'm wondering, but that notion, what John was just saying about, you know, and I seem to remember this in one of them, maybe it was in Tommy's report, that more artistic directors are aware that the subscribers who are the long-term ticket buyers who really love the theater and want different experiences are more, whatever the opposite of risk-averse, they're riskier. Whereas playwrights' perception that it's actually those long-term subscribers that mitigate against this.
Yeah.
And that's a really, that to me was really provocative. Mm-hmm. The other thing which I'm thinking about, Emily and I were just in New Orleans this past week to see the closing of a production of a playwright who's been working here and with the National New Play Network, Peter Nocturne, who's a San Francisco Bay Area playwright. And Peter's a wild, you know, foul mouth, crazy, cartoon, you know, sort of pop comic playwright, and I spent the two nights seeing it, watching the older people in the audience, and you know, and seeing that what were my assumptions that the older white ladies in the front room, the New Orleans audiences, were going to be horrified once he started talking about anal penetration and the fucks just started flying. You know, some of the things that are risk factors in your study. And
plays you wouldn't take your mother to.
The Bay Area. Plays you should definitely use a condom on. But in fact, it really was different from row to row and person to person. So those same, you know, older white ladies in the front row wound up on the floor with laughter. And then there was another group behind me that didn't crack a smile. Mm. And then there were young people that didn't crack a smile and others that were all over. So I kept being sort of thrown both by the context of a different city, a different theater, a playwright who in New York would not seem shocking at all, except insofar as they were essentially. And then putting them in a different context and thinking about that at Lloyd and Z space versus Southern Rap.
Yeah.
And so these factors that are so changeable from place to place.
I was thinking, I think it's very hard to think about the defining what represents risk for your audience, because you can't make them into a monolith. And we've talked a lot about this. It's really cool. Every time we start this conversation about our program, even and we're trying to think about what they would experience. We're making sweeping generalizations about people that are actually diverse in many ways, if not in all of the obvious ways.
Mm-hmm.
And I think we started to talk about it more at the Atlantic in terms of habit, not risk. And by habit, I mean what have we habituated our habitual customers to expect? What are our habits in programming that are reflected in the tastes of our audience? So, because I believe that we need them to an appreciation of whatever risk might mean to them. I don't actually think most people think about that word when they're buying a ticket to a play or not. They feel excited or like an opportunity, presumably, to actually purchase a ticket. But we're talking about, well, how have we habituated them, or how do we want to reconstruct their theater-going habits so that the things that we perceive that are a little outside the box for us are possible without massive financial risk.
Carol?
Well, to jump first on thought, I think we underestimate many things.
Talk a little louder.
We underestimate our subscription base.
because we all have older white subscription bases, we do. But you know, they're also very smart bases, you know. And I do think we sometimes sell them short, and I think the playwright sometimes, and that when you say the perception is off. Oh, you know, here come those old people who aren't gonna like it. And I think, you know, we've done a couple of riskier things recently at Playwright, you know. I don't think normally we would be programming, you know, Mr. Burns, even this Larry sort of thing. Are those older subscribers going to like that? And I think it's been great, you know, and it's been rewarding for them to, some of them loving it, some of them saying, hating it, but like, I'm here for the ride. And, you know, okay, it wasn't my favorite. So
those of you who
underestimate the subscribers.
Those of you who are artists or playwrights or have worn those hats or deal intimately with them, I think this issue of the different perception is a big one. When we were in Washington, you know, there was a little bit of a free, you know, the playwrights were very much on the side of what the playwrights in Zani's study felt, and the people from the theaters were very much echoing as you are. And it seems to me that's one of the places that we need to figure out how to unpack. And I wonder if any of you have had any success either understanding that as a writer or navigating, or a director or navigating that fear, and or as producers, really. I mean, you know, I remember, Mandy, when we were, it was a conversation we always ran away from. I certainly always ran away from it when the playwrights were like up in arms about who the subscribers were. And it was like, I never quite figured out how to have that conversation and convince anyone that in fact they were there and they were hanging in, and they were there for the ride. And I wonder if other people
I think we've had to become far more transparent and far more willing to engage. Because it also, I think this conversation with artists also shapes how we make the piece, right? In many instances, in the time that I've been at MTC, the biggest clearly definable risks that we take and that people around this room might actually call a risk. By the way, I think it's very but by the way, it's actually, you know, like, I have pretty controversial feelings about this, right? I think doing Snow Geese on Broadway by Char White with Mary Louise Parker is a big risk. Others may not,
right?
But world premiering a new American play is a big risk, and an actress with a very high profile creating a role is a big
Well, and if you look at some of the work, most people don't care about who's in the work anyway.
Right.
So
you know, but I accept that there's,
okay,
you know,
a difference,
range,
right.
Right. So, you know, take for example, on one end of the spectrum, just, you know, in our recent history, Murder Ballad or Matthew Lopez's play The Whipping Man, plays that or Blackbird, plays that seem to be kind of outlierish in their content or form to what is expected at the Manhattan Theater Club. Engaging with the writers and the directors and, frankly, with the actors about what are we going to do to lay bare that problem has become part of the sort of foundational work we're doing as we develop the piece, as we think about, you know, aspects of even designing the piece. I mean, it really has become part of the artistic dialogue in some ways, in some of the most, you know, extreme, in quotation marks, understanding there's large range.
So that's so that you would say that's a conversation strategy. You have conversations with the artists about the issue.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah.
Absolutely. How to confront it, how to deal with it, how not to deal with it, how to embrace it, how to fix it, you know. It really has become sort of foundational, in some instances, to getting the artists to do it with Manhattan.
Do you things particularly to prepare the audience for that or to help them process it afterwards?
I don't think we've gone that far. I'm really only answering the question, sort of the a priori piece of it, of like, here's a piece that we internally and the artists acknowledge involves a kind of aesthetic risk.
Mm-hmm.
Let's leave it an aesthetic risk.
what are we going to do given what we know about who we are and who comes to see it, to acknowledge that in some of the choices we're going to make, both about the piece itself and how it comes to life in our theater, and about how we get the right people in to see it. Yeah. But how the audience digests it, I don't know that we've gone
there yet.
Or if we have mid-dance.
Yeah, I mean, we don't work with subscribers.
Right.
So we're kind of outside of that.
I'm curious to hear from you.
But and we don't, because the work is so vastly different, because we work in so many different disciplines.
Right.
And
there is no monolithic anything.
There's no one besides me and Kim who want to see everything we program this season. It's just too much weird stuff. But I think the thing that we do think about is it's a long-term development process that we do with the artists, and we start thinking about who's the community you're making this work for at the beginning of that process. So we start having...
And when does it begin?
Right when they're starting their development with us, which could be 3 years before we're going to produce it. So we start thinking about who do you want to, who are you making this work for, who do you want to talk to, and how do we start a conversation with them now? So when you do your first work in progress in 3 months, we're thinking, like, who would be good people to be a part of that and to give you feedback? And then we're going to do another one in 6 months. And what organization might we ally ourselves with? Because that's going to help the piece down the road. So we think about the strategic steps that we can take to build a community that's the right community for this show, because our audience isn't one audience. It's different audiences for every show we make. So we think differently, almost from scratch.
From scratch.
I think that what we do is somewhat similar in that our audience follows us wherever we go, and we're doing things that are different. And we're very interested in contextualizing work, and we've really been trying to bring the audience early into the process. I think that the obstacle that we come up against in terms of that is people's time. And whether we're, if we're inviting people into a process to see something earlier or to meet the artist, which always has a huge payoff because they're always very interested in the artist later on, and it allows us...
And how do you know there's payoff?
Because they keep asking us about those artists, or they want to meet them, or if they're at another event where we're bringing those same artists in terms of our artistic community, there's just this interest that we know creates the kind of investment we want.
Right.
But there always feels like a risk to us if we bring them in this early, will they not show up to the show? Will they then not show up to the next thing? Because the premium, it seems, at least in this city, is time. And because our audience is a little bit younger, and they have children, work, and blah, 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 all these sort of other things that are going on. So that intent is there. And I think that the thing that's interesting about the MTC conversation with the artists is we really want to bring that same conversation about risk to our audience, because all we do, you said, are like untested, unknown things that seem risky, and so we show up, and we've always tried to contextualize them on paper and on our web stuff, and the way that people can read about things, but how can we contextualize it in terms of the community and still making it work, is the next question. Because I know that gets people interested, no matter how we play as a seeming normal person, our time in terms of human resources and the time of our audience.
Yeah. Yeah. Ben, and then...
Yeah, I just wanted to say that it's interesting to me to think about how risk is being defined in this conversation and in the document that we were that we read in terms of that. Manny just used the term aesthetic risk, which I thought was great, because most of the conversation before that seemed to be about essentially box office risk.
Mm-hmm.
What happens if we do a play and it flops or whatever? And obviously that's, box office is an issue for most theaters, but I would imagine it's very different for a New Georgia's kind of environment, which has a completely different kind of audience than NTC. When I say kind of audience, I don't mean demographically, but I mean in terms of
how they buy their tickets,
what their buying patterns are. And then also I wonder about what the artists perceive as risk, since royalty, I don't think any playwrights out there anymore are expecting to make their living through royalties so much. What are the aesthetic risks that pertain, to the writers, and what are the risks for, and I don't mean to take on me, but, you made a good point about producing a play by a new writer with a star on Broadway, so there are risks involved in that too, from the company's point of view, risks in terms of the perception of their work, whatever, I don't know. So those are important kinds of risks too, and I wonder whether, it's hard to look at the survey data and see how much of it plays in. I have, and I'll talk about this later, but I have some observations about what theaters tell me they think risk entails, which I haven't heard anybody talk about later.
Well, Like what?
Like what? Don't tease us.
Well, I might be somebody who asks theaters to tell, to propose risky projects.
This is through the funding source, right?
Half of the plays that people talk to us about are plays either by writers of color or stories about people of color. And to me, I don't think that those plays, I think that a lot of those plays in themselves are risky in that they have large casts and that they use language in difficult ways. I don't think those are like, you know, really conventional plays that have to be written by a writer of color. But to me, there's an association in the risk of the people who I've been talking with, most of whom are in the, you know, establishment theater community, whatever you want to call it, the mainstream theaters. There's an association in the mind of those producers with those works and risk. Mm-hmm. I just offer that.
Mm-hmm. Other thoughts, Todd?
Well, one thing, another sort of slippage in this notion of risk, and I was struck by what Cam said, is the one-shottedness of risk, or the constancy of it in some way. But we're talking about aesthetic risk. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, I was really struck as you were talking, Carol, because, I mean, frankly, I think Playwrights Horizons has done a phenomenal job in the last few seasons of kind of cross the borders. Do you know what I mean? And then talking about here, or New Georges, or Club Plum, or something, everything is new. You know, everything you do is in some way new, which is really different than, I mean, as you were singling out Mr. Burns, I was thinking you don't really need to single out Mr. Burns in the season with the flick and, you know, all the various things, and Kirk Lynn, you know, all these things. It's not.
Yes, I have many.
You have many. It's absolutely true, but suddenly the baseline is different.
Yes.
And so it isn't like, will my audience accept Mr. Burns? It's kind of like, we've changed the frame. Mm-hmm. And so I do think, you know, part of it is like being really precise. Are we talking about seasons of risk and canons of risk, or are we talking about a risky play here or there, or, you know, even like As You Like It in the context of all the new play, as opposed to next season you're going to do all Shakespeare. That would be a context.
You know, I think risk also has to take into consideration the ways of storytelling. For instance, some of the many case histories that are practicing theater in a very alternative fashion, taking it into the streets, into the parks, but really breaking down that fourth wall. And risk, I think, certainly encompasses the ways music, puppetry, so many different mediums are intersecting. And I think that sometimes it's almost hard to describe what is theater as a definition. And just, I do have a little question, I don't want to digress, but I'm a little, I have a question about all of this alternative ways of theater making, taking it into community engagement, and what does it do with our traditional definition of excellence, or standards of training, or standards of excellence, or certainly the union aspects, actors' equity, when we, and SDC, directors and choreographers. Meaning, when you're, and of course, a playwright, for instance, collective, communal creation, who then owns the property, who owns, and are these some of the, are these valid questions to ask? Because I find that very interesting. So, I don't know, I open it up to people who are practicing.
The issue of community, I remember saying to Brad that one of the regional differences that at least surfaces sometimes in conversations and then that we had before is that I think this community's, the New York theater community's sense of its community is a little different than a lot of other places. And so I'm interested in this, I mean, a lot of the reading that you do on building audiences and opening up the process and building connections to the artists and where does the institution fit into the community have to do with ideas of community engagement. And by and large, we don't talk so much about that here in the city. We talk about the work we did. And so I would be curious to know people's thoughts about that and playwrights you've written and how playwrights feel about the community and talking to, you know, reaching out and knowing who the audience is and are you part of the community? And you've now gone out of the city. I mean, I'm just, it's something to think about.
I mean, you know, there are a lot of arts organizations in our neighborhood in Chelsea. We've variously over the years that I've been there tried to kind of band together with other arts organizations to kind of create some sort of audience sharing coalition to cross-pollinate between us and Joyce and Dancing with Joy, New York Live Arts Now, or The Kitchen, or, you know, capitalizing the diversity there. And it doesn't work. And it's not because there's a willingness, but I think it's all, it speaks to the fact also that the people who live in New York City don't think about community in the same way either. You know, that people who live in Chelsea don't necessarily assume that they should get their entertainment in Chelsea. They don't know to the net, or go over to the east side, or go wherever they want to go. And so that the locality of theaters in some ways outside of New York, where there are fewer options and where there's a different kind of mobility, affects the way the audience and the local organizations think, I think, a little bit. We would love to be, we've got our little theaters on our side streets, and, you know, seems like a perfectly charming neighborhood thing to do. We want to encourage people in the neighborhood to walk down 20th Street and look at our nice old church and come into the box office, a brand new box office that we just opened, and buy tickets. And, we haven't figured that out yet. Not we won't keep trying, but we definitely thought about it. But I think it isn't just the organizations that are, we're running up against the same problematic assumptions, or not problematic, but the similar assumptions in the community itself. They're not looking to stay in Chelsea.
Okay, Shannon, and then.
Yeah, just a couple thoughts. One, to go back to the original thought about risk, and, you know, Thomas said it's not just a one-time thing, it's an equation. And it really is. I mean, to me, it's not so much. It's not so much about people assessing why they're going to the theater, but what they're coming out of the theater with. And it's almost more a, you know, it's that feeling that you get from going to a show versus, and it's so intangible in a lot of ways, but I think that surveying people as to how the effect on them afterward is a big part of this that we haven't really touched on yet, but I know that's part of the
intrinsic
impact.
Yeah.
Studies and surveys and intrinsic impact that's been happening. And the other thing, just to talk about audiences and risky plays, if you were talking about plays by artists of color, and then from the audience side, is it an expectation of artists of color to see an audience that looks like them? Because we as marketers are constantly under pressure to create an audience that reflects the playwright. And I don't necessarily know, is that the most important thing, or is the important thing like the reach and the change and the effect on people? That
where does that pressure come from, to put you on the spot a little bit?
It comes from artistic, a lot of times
right.
We have this playwright, we're doing a play, and the audience has to contain this many people that look like this. And so we're kind of thinking, like, is that the most important factor, or yes, of course, we want diverse audiences, and that is something that we work really hard to bring new people in and engage people in the theater. And I mean, honestly, as far as the artist audience connection, the biggest thing that we've done is was not even our idea, it was Susan Laurie Parks' idea to do Watch Me Work, where she literally goes and sits in her lobby and has people come in and sit around her while she's working. And then, you know,
do they talk to her?
So there's a period where they don't talk to her, they do their own work, and then they come in on their laptops or their iPads or whatever, and then they have a conversation afterwards. And then, you know, here she's been doing this for a year and a half now, and now we're producing her show, you know, so there's this sort of, she has delved into who are the people that are coming into this building, why do they matter to me, what is their interest in me, how is it affecting my work. And as an artist, that's very interesting to us as marketers, too, which is her sort of trying to cross that bridge. Hopefully it's a bridge and not a wall. But she built that bridge. It wasn't us saying, you have to go sit in the lobby.
Yeah, that's fascinating. So, and do you guys talk to the artists about, to the playwrights about who they want to see in the audience? I mean, like Wooly's doing that now. Design, you know, they design the audience. Of course, they have a large subscription audience, so how much of it is actually designed? But they design the rest of it, or you know, they're trying to around what the playwright actually wants to see in the room.
We do not. Our relationship is typically one step removed.
Mm-hmm.
Tom?
Can I just say, and roundabout, I mean, we look very much at sort of both tracks parallel. I mean, existing audience of subscription is a reality, a positive reality, that has to live alongside the audience development opportunities around each production. So we can't necessarily be looking at how can we change this entirely, but what opportunities exist parallel to what we already have, as part of our sort of market share or our profile. I had a point on an earlier question, if I can just about the whole need for New York arts organizations to focus on community engagement. I guess, you know, it's a very simplistic way of looking at it from a marketing perspective, but as a reality, there are lists I know of hundreds of thousands of arts goers in New York City. Those don't necessarily exist in other markets at the same level, per se. I mean, I know that there are exceptions, of course. But just for theater alone, there are a list of hundreds of thousands of theater goers. So the necessity is that they may not necessarily have been there historically to get out and do that kind of work, to get out and sort of cultivate a demand for our work in the same way. And again, obviously, I'm conscious of the fact that I'm talking from the largest theater of time, so I'm not necessarily speaking for everyone. But I just think that the challenge in front of us looks very different, and it's starting to look here a little bit more like it's looking in other places.
Well, and I was picking up on Tisa's issue, though, of there's also a kind of, when you start reading stuff about what's really working, you know, or where there's vibrancy and what's creating new vibrant audiences, and you look at Cornerstone, you look at a lot of places where there's a lot of work that's engaging the community, and but the flip side of that, which I hear in New York a lot, is, but what does that mean about this? What does it mean about excellence? What does it mean about training? What does it mean about those things? And I wonder what we communicate to our audiences about that, I guess, is part of what I'm thinking about. Is because I'm really stuck with your idea, Christian, of habituating, right, and what we think people expect.
Yeah, I feel like there are these small slices of people that are the right people for this project. Mm-hmm. And it's about how you reach those right people. Mm-hmm. It's strategic. In New York, I think it's like we have a glut of choices, but there's also a glut of competition. And we have to find a way to distinguish who we are for those people who are looking for what we have to offer. So for us, like, adventurous is one of the things that we have on everything, because if you like adventurous, mm-hmm. we're the place for you. We're one of the places for you, you know. And so it's about how you are, who are the right partners strategically for this particular project, who you can ally yourselves with. And so you borrow those lists, those names for that one project. But the next project, it's not going to be those same names. So the community has to shift based on the project.
How do you figure that out, or how do you think about that?
We do that with the artists. I mean, we sit and we brainstorm, like, what are shows recently that happened, or artists you know who mm-hmm. work that you think are related to your work, mm-hmm. who are theaters that you think are making similar-minded mm-hmm. projects. Mm-hmm. And it's on all different levels. And so sometimes the artists that they list are then artists that we say, hey, will you guys do a talk back
right.
with this artist about this work? Because then people who know that artist's work, uh-huh. they look on the card and they go, oh, I love that artist. Yeah, so yeah. I don't know this artist, but I love that artist. So I'm going to go check this thing out.
Uh-huh.
We do a version of that for every show that we do. And we do work short-run shows in small theaters, but we talk to the playwright and director to sort of isolate people, either people within the field who might be particularly interested in this project, you know, other collaborators, writers groups, and members of it. Sometimes it's like, oh, you're the other parents on your kid's baseball team, whatever it might be, and we try and find kind of like a social ringleader for each of those and have a group come in the front row.
Do you charge them? No, because it's interesting. One of the things we heard
and
in Washington,
are cheap as, you know,
right? They're really cheap, so it's okay. But that someone,
well, people still charge.
Yeah. Well,
that's a relative bar. But it's really, I think, part of it. What we've, because there isn't a really, there's so much overlap in our audience and our community and our artists.
So talk about that, unpack that a little bit more, would you?
Club Thumb is in so many ways, is an incubator.
Right.
A very high percentage of our audience is somehow in the field,
mm-hmm.
or was, or will be, and our audience is pretty young. And we do almost all of our producing in, like, rapid succession, and it's a bit of an event. a lot of thought into the social experience of going to the theater. In like school, enjoy going to the theater together. Who will not put off making plans to go to the theater because their friends are going to the theater, or their members of their whatever little subgroup who isolated are going to the theater that night. And we try and make sure that the sort of pre and post show experience is charismatic as well as the show itself. So I mean, for our audience and our community and our artists, it's less about explaining the material, either helping them digest it afterwards or paving the way beforehand, because a lot of, that's not something that our audience has voiced when we've tried. It's not been especially well attended, and I'm the first person to run if I see that a talk back is happening. But people stay in the lobby forever,
right.
And they come early, and you know, it spills out all over the street. So, like, I mean, for us, it's a matter of also like our theater selection. We try and make sure that we're in places where people can have that together. That we create that environment for them, but we're not necessarily dictating what the terms of that conversation are going to be.
I'd really like to say something to this. What's your name?
Shannon.
Yes. About playwrights of color, and then expecting and what the audience should comprise of. I think playwrights of color would like to have audiences that can really appreciate the work. And very often there are nuances and resonance that can speak perhaps then to an African-American playwright would welcome perhaps a reaction from an African-American audience. I think that there, I found it interesting that you used the word pressure rather than, let's say, commitment, because I think when larger theaters who don't usually do playwrights of color want to produce such a playwright, I think that you take, and I find that that's a great opportunity exactly to not only to try to expand your audience reach, but also to give a different kind of perception to the kind of work. I would take it as a welcome opportunity to embrace new people.
I'm just a little averse to the idea of teaching people how to be theater lovers. That has always, like, you know, that, like, come on, you'll love it, we'll show you how, sort of mentality, rather than an opportunity to engage people for the right reasons, as opposed to trying to just show that audience, which is what we're sort of tasked with. Where we do want to rather take the opportunity road, which is more of like, is this appropriate, who's appropriate, are they at one time deserved and we're done, or is there some way for us to build that and have people come to other shows?
Well, one of the things, one of the things that's interesting that we heard in Washington was this word pressure in the context of marketing directors. And a marketing director in Washington said, I sometimes feel like we are charged with solving all of the problems that the artistic staff and their artists haven't worked out for each other. And so I think that may be where the language of pressure comes from. Let's come back to that maybe at the end, a little bit of conversation about what are we asking the folks that in the large institutions, not so much in the small institutions where the staff is not that deep, but you know, what's that pressure to say, I'm imposing this and you go fix it, Jeremy? And then
you didn't
coming from smaller institutions, I just like to say the staff's pretty deep. Yeah.
I met lots of people.
Just saying, we're shallow. We are incredibly shallow. Partially out of self-interest, I would expand the conversation about who's reflected in the audience beyond just ethnicity or race, and add age to that mix, and add socioeconomic status to that mix. And the fact of the matter is, I just went from a theater where the top ticket price was $30 to a theater where the average ticket price is $75. And the idea that we're gonna cultivate an audience that doesn't have resources to bring their laptop or their iPad to sit in the middle of the day with a Pulitzer Prize winning playwright. We're talking about a pretty rarefied set of people here. And so I think that, you know, if you want to be seeing another set of people reflected in the audience, I think it's far less about the marketing of the play, far less than about the content and the form of the play. And, you know, I sat in on a roundtable of off-Broadway theater producers in my first 6 months when I was managing director of Ars Nova, and I was like, I don't know why I'm here. And then we started talking about young audiences, and I was like, I know why I'm here now. And the difference that I said to that group and that I still believe is that, you know, a theater like Ars Nova, a theater potentially like, you know, Club Thumb is working with not only young artists in Club Thumb's case, but, you know, a lot of, it's an incubator and they're developing new work. And so you're going to see younger audiences, both because the work is cheaper, but also because the work reflects them and their lives and their stories. Mm-hmm. Now, the best of that work also appeals to a broader audience, and the same thing can be true for anybody telling a specific story, whether it's set in a different country or whether it's people of a different ethnicity. But, you know, as long as we are producing predominantly, and I don't mean any one institution, but as a group, plays about wealthy white people on the Upper West Side, you know, or Upper East Side, or any place that just has a side, you know, you are...
Or Brooklyn now.
That's... Well, that's yeah, sure.
Why'd you just call me out?
That's... sorry. You know, that's what, those are the people we're going to see in our audiences. And if we're going to charge $75-$85 a ticket, even if we're going to charge $50 or $60 a ticket, you know, you're only going to see people who are willing to shell out $50 or $60. And I think that there is...
And who can.
And able, right?
Yeah. And for whom that is
who
nothing.
Think they can.
But for whom that is nothing, because it's not a risk. And I think that goes back to the thing that just going to the theater is a risk. And, you know, it's a risk that a lot of us get to take for free or discountedly through various means, and that we sometimes feel compelled to take because we know people or whatever, but that we are used to taking and habitualized. You know, that is an ongoing habit for the people in this room. And it is, even for the most ardent theater goers at our theaters, it is far less of a habit than it is for us. And there has to be not just one play with an African-American cast to develop an African-American audience. And that audience is going to come and they're going to see that play, and then they're not going to come back. And it's not because they have failed us. It is because we have failed them. And the same thing is true of audiences who are young, and the same thing is true of audiences with fewer resources. You know, if you do that one young person play in a season, you'll get that one group of young people to come and see it, but you are not going to develop a younger audience. And the same thing, I think, is true across all of the audiences we talk about wanting to develop.
Yeah, I guess as a playwright of color, there's a lot of issues here. I don't necessarily write a piece of work for a specific demographic. You know, I don't write an Asian play. I write a play, hopefully, with a good story. So in that sense, you know, I'm not expecting my audience to be Asian or to be anything other than somebody who will appreciate a good story. So I think that's important to note. And actually, I'm, you know, a member of Emerging Writers Group at the Public, so, you know, I'm working with them at the same time. I think the engagement between a playwright and a community can be much tighter. You know, I'm not so familiar with New York because I'm still new to this community, but I lived in LA for 10 years, and I feel that there's much more of a interaction between the playwright, the creator, and the community. Mm-hmm. I work with a small theater over there, and they faced a huge problem. The theater went away, the space went away, and they were trying to start something completely new after 3 years of inactivity. Mm. And what they decided to do was to curate a group of diverse artists and playwrights, and then starting to reach out to various communities, ethnically, you know. Like during the, you know, Black History Month, they will stage a black play. They will do, you know, during Christmas, maybe they'll do a more Latino play, maybe it's issue-based, then they will also have a Asian playwright. So in that sense, I think they were able to create a community involvement in you know, for the audience. And in that sense, they have been very successful. There's very little crossover, you know, you have to build a community, you know, from start every time. But that only happened for the first couple of years. I was with them for 4 or 5 years. Mm-hmm. They realized that they could bridge the different the different communities by having a short play festival
where different communities can come and witness people of different ethnicity doing their work. And then some of those people then came back for, you know, some other.
And how long did that take, would you say? 2 years? 3 years?
Two to three years. Yeah, and it was this short play festival that allowed that crossover.
That's
right.
Fascinating. Yeah. What was the name of that company in
LA? Company of Angels.
Company of Angels. Thanks.
Todd, Mandy, Christian.
I hear that, you know, also in the context of the story about Susan Laurie bringing hers in, you know, things that we've heard a lot during that religious fortune process, thinking about people like Louis Alfaro, poets who go into a theater and they make a beeline for marketing.
Mm-hmm. Right.
You know, they want to know how to get their audience in. Yep. And I keep going back to that statistic, which I only vaguely remember from Zani's paper here, which is the difference in perception between the leaders of the theater and the playwrights about how integrated they are
with their marketing director. I don't know if you all remember, like, most of the theaters said their marketing directors were totally integrated with the efforts, and most of the playwrights said that the marketing directors knew nothing about it.
And that seems so powerful, because your example, James, right? Yeah, is that the direct relationship of the artist to his or her audience, just sort of like with Susan Laurie, or when I think about Louise. And so I know that's what you guys are going at, ultimately in some way, the bridge and not the wall.
Right.
But I just wanted to circle that, because I do think that perceptual difference is a place up to add pressure.
Yeah. Well, one of the things that was so interesting to me, and we touched on it a couple times, was that another point of difference in perception was the playwrights thinking that the ideal, I mean, this is, you know, on the whole.
Yeah,
but the ideal audience was younger and more diverse, and the theater companies were saying, no, they're older and they're more Caucasian, which we were like, isn't that exactly like your subscription audience? And then why are you afraid of doing new work if the best audience looks exactly like your subscribers? But there, but where that perception difference was
and
coming
it's,
from
it's
was
important to note that the audience stuff and Alan stuff, which I should have said at the beginning, was based in large part on surveys done at Steppenwolf and South Coast.
Yeah.
And we owe them a thank you for sharing. Mm-hmm. Be letting him use all that stuff, but it was places where
it really skews towards a certain kind of
right.
audience.
Right, and so I think that's when we do more this summer, I think, you know, if you dig deeper, you may get a different, but anyway, did you have something?
Yeah, I was thinking that when I read the stuff you sent, the thing that jumped out at me was that discrepancy between the playwrights and marketing. That people thought the interaction was, and I thought, in my experience, I'm always like, hey, let me help with the audience getting, let me be involved, and you know, unlike the Susan Laurie Parks was, you know, really nothing to really bring a new idea, but I've always sort of felt like, hey, can we brainstorm? And actually, that's not what maybe people were interested in, because I don't know the marketing side. I mean, I've been mainly listening because I'm thinking, well, I want to learn something here because I don't know what it takes to fill a theater, especially a big theater. But I, you know, it usually ends up just being a matter of, oh, great, you were available to do an interview. Like, yes, I do. And I totally am. But can we go beyond that? But, you know, but I also, you know, as well, that I'm not, you know, maybe I need to brainstorm with myself and bring them ideas, but I do want to be a part of that process, because I have, you know, not quite as much at stake, you know, in a practical sense. I mean, there's all in the theater, you know, there's a lot of jobs, you know, on the line to sell tickets, but on the other hand, it's my life.
Right.
It's on the line, really.
You have a lot at stake. You have a lot at stake, right.
Yeah, so, you know, I'm not, you know, I'm not precious about it. I'd be like, hey, want to rewrite the title? I mean, what will sell tickets? I'm going to get in there, other than, you know, they're flying to get one across necessarily. But the other thing I just want to say about that, I mean, I think that if I wasn't in the theater, I don't think I would go to the theater, because there are so many barriers.
And what are some of those,
well,
do you think?
Well, you know, this is the thing. I and this is, you know, you can take this as a very naive point of view, you know, because I've never had to try to, you know, keep people's jobs by selling tickets. But I wish when I have my daydreams about starting a little theater, I wish that it was as simple as going to the movies. You know, you say to somebody, hey, let's go see a movie. It's not necessarily about there's a movie you want to see. It's an experience you feel like having. In the moment. And you walk over to the box office and you buy a ticket and you go in. The ticket isn't expensive. And you don't have to plan ahead. And you can change your mind on the day.
That's called London.
Yes.
Go ahead, Jeremy.
I think this takes me all the way back to when Tori, you brought up that the survey said that people will say they don't care that actors are in the show. The reason that we think about movies as a form of entertainment, I mean, there are many, many reasons, but that can be spur of the moment, are that we are exposed to movies all the time. And part of that is because they're on TV, and part of that is because they spend more than half of the budget for movie marketing the movie. So if there is a level of cognitive ease in our automatically going to a movie as a movie as an idea, and then specific movies, right? Like, I don't know if everybody or anybody has seen 12 Years a Slave, and I'm not interested in necessarily analyzing the movie, but it is a difficult movie, and more people will have seen 12 Years a Slave than What's It All About, Bacharach Reimagined, which is, I will tell you, though I think beautiful, not a difficult evening. And so there is, and that's
about like honesty in the conversation.
That's because there was, we spent, in as we always do, which is an insane business model, we spent somewhere south of $100,000 launching a new idea in the world. Whereas 12 Years a Slave, a not a little independent movie, but would have spent at least 10 times as much, if not 20 or 30 or 40 times as much. So many, it's going to be a lot easier to think about the idea of going to see a movie than it is to go see a play, even in London. Even in cultures where theater going is more regular. And, putting stars in something isn't necessarily about convincing you or the audience member filling out a survey that they are, that's their reason for buying a ticket, that, oh, Denzel Washington is in that, so I'm going to buy a ticket. Obviously, that is a factor. But another factor is the press covers it. They get on TV. The name of that play is put in front of audiences 50 or 60 times more because Mary Louise Parker is in it than because, an equally talented actor who no one has ever heard of is in it. And that, again, that ease of recall leads people to buy the ticket with less resistance.
I think you're talking about perceived opportunity cost, though. That goes to the question of barriers, which is that we don't do it, whatever our programming is, we're not doing a great job of making the experience for somebody who actually might be already predisposed to seek the theater as an opportunity. Mm-hmm. We're not doing a good job of presenting them with a hospitable experience from the moment that they have that thought.
Definitely.
Which goes to our ticketing systems suck in our 1998.
Yep.
Our websites are behind the times of ugly and hard to navigate.
And also don't tell you where the theater is.
That's my point.
Our play materials contain too many words, and they contain too much about too many things. When you get to the theater, it's a small, cold lobby, and there's nowhere to put your coat. The food costs more than it would anywhere else, except in the theater. We're not thinking about, I'm not just talking about barriers to talk about barriers, but I think we're not also in the conversation about risk and the conversation of habituating audiences to an experience, we're not thinking about the totality of the experience. I think you're absolutely right. The content has to drive it. You're not going to generate an excited young audience by producing a play about young people or by young people, created by young people every few years. But you're also not going to, see people if they don't have a pleasurable experience from the minute they think of the idea, from the minute they read.
Totally.
I don't know. I feel like we always have
of 10 gazillion things to say, but I just wanted to go back to one thing that I wasn't thinking in this way until you said this thing about the movies, but the liveness of it is, you know, I mean, in some ways, the way you speak of it, I've never thought of it that way, is a liability, that, you know, because we can't do a 1 o'clock, a 3 o'clock, mm. 6 o'clock, you know, and make it convenient to whenever you can go. That's just easy to kind of, but I've always thought it's our greatest virtue. I think that's why we do it. But just to go back, I just wanted to loop to, you know, this conversation about bridges versus walls. It's really fascinating. I thought I think I am the only person who's fascinated by my thought about this. But but you know, because I spent 20 years in New York, most of my time in the public theater. I go to this theater now, we're in Red Bank, New Jersey, 40 miles outside of New York. And I'm taking my New Yorkness with me, and some of that is great, and much of that is really problematic. And then I'm trying to figure out how to make hay out of what's problematic. Yeah. And a lot of it has to do with this bridge versus wall. I never understood. We didn't talk about this in the public theater, bridges and walls. Susan Lurie's idea is a new one, and actually she inspired me down in Red Bank. You know, I feel like the thing that I'm trying to figure out how to do is. I got there and I said this thing, you know, I'll never probably get big celebrities to come and be at my little theater in Jersey. So I'm going to make celebrities out of people. And I decided I'm going to make celebrities out of playwrights. And this is what this has been my big project. And it can happen in a place like that, which just because I realized it couldn't happen in New York. To have a playwright come to a gala is a very different thing in Red Bank than what it was in New York. It's just, it means so much different. They come, they're from residence. We're doing this thing with Maria and Club Thumb, which we just started last year as a kind of pilot residency. Get artists down there. They came down last year. We live by the beach, which is a fabulous thing. You know, they came in that part, which is great for the artists. But what I'm going to insist that we do next year is that they now are going to take a role in being part of our community and connect up with our audiences. And for these audiences to start to see that I'm going to make somebody out of a human being that I'm going to invest in, and I'm going to celebritize, and therefore I'm going to start to want to come and be part of what you're doing. It's something we're trying to do all throughout the year with all of the things that we're doing. And it's just interesting, because until I never thought of bridges and walls. I thought we were all bridging, that's what we're all doing, but now I see, because I can feel like we are actually making bridges, that that's possible and productive. And, you know, leads to, hopefully, it's a little bit leading to some people coming, new people coming to the theater.
Mm-hmm. I don't want to shut down back and forth, it's hard, because everybody wants to talk, but anyway.
I was going to say something that has a lot to do with that, I think, and also what I was going to say before Maria spoke, obviously we're very similar, but in terms of this idea of community, and that it's very hard to find a community in New York City in terms of geographical community because we all flow between them so much. So I think that our approach has always been similarly that the theater is a community. And what is the community we're building? And of course, our community has always primarily been made up of artists and friends of artists who come to see our shows. So the challenge becomes how do you bring more people into the community, and to what I was saying before about them meeting the star artists, or who we consider to be star artists and city stars, and doing something kind of very similar, and how do you bring more of those people so that they will follow us to and fro and do those things, and that so many people long lost in train of thought, but the idea that, because I was always very jealous of the idea that other people would have these communities that felt geographical and people needed something. But I think that what we're thinking, I mean, I always look to this food thing and how everyone's obsessed with the food because they want to be together and they want to, you know, do something that's pleasurable, that's what Christians say. And so if you can have this fun and you can have this thing centered around the thing that we love and put forth why we love this thing that we love, because there's a different sense of community, and you can bring people in and hopefully they'll come back because they feel, well, they're making a community for me, and I'm in this vast city trying to find a community that speaks to me.
Yeah, I mean, I was thinking about this barrier issue too, about access, and
when I was in Moscow, every night the theaters are full, and I realized what happens every night is right before the curtain, there are all the drama students and the theater students outside waiting to get in, because if there are empty seats, they get them for free. And so every night, every seat is full because there are all these kids who are desperate to come into these theaters. And so I was like, that's brilliant. So we're doing it now, but we have to work really hard to spread the word. You can see tickets, you can see shows for free any night here if you have a student ID. But we're trying to spread that word, and it's starting to happen now that every night we do have students coming, but it's been very slow to catch on because it's not part of our culture. So this thing about it being in our DNA that we think that, oh, it's worth the risk to go see if I can get in. And so now it's starting to happen, but it's interesting that we've been doing it for like almost 3 years now. It's only now that every night we're starting to get people.
I have no idea.
Can I ask a question about that?
Yeah.
How many seats are you filling now, 3 years in? Like, you know, is it?
Well, like we had last week, we had something like 30 students come for one particular thing. But usually it's like just 5 or 10.
Yeah.
But that's cool to have 5 or 10 students come every night.
Because the biggest space here is how big?
Right? Our base 150 is our base here.
So it's 10% more, but that's a huge thing.
Yeah, but it's overcoming those that feeling that can you get in, can you afford it, do you have access to it, but getting people to accept that they do.
Well, I would suggest that, I mean, and I'm curious what some of the, either the marketing folks or Carol, anyway. I think part of what gets in the way of it's like a film is that we do. Part of our definition of success is that it's hard to get a ticket, right? I mean, we don't want to, and I think that's more true here than some other places, right? We make it, if there's access, then it must not be good, right? Mm-hmm. But we define successful as really hard to get into. Mm. And so then folks think, well, I can't do that, right? And there usually are empty seats, Tom.
And further to that, you know, when you look at the cultural phenomena that are taking off, there are things that are inherently shareable. And we don't encourage, in most theaters, perhaps because of all larger institutional theaters, the ability to share the experience with your social channels, your digital medium. Not only do we not encourage it, we shut it off. And so we're missing an opportunity there. We're not only we're hoping for scarcity of tickets, we're also making the experience more and more rarefied, more and more scarce by not allowing people to broadcast. Mm-hmm. I'm not saying we should be up in every actor's face flashing a camera in their eyes, but at the same time, the ability to even photograph a set before a show is completely off limits. And that's, in the 21st century, it's just becoming completely archaic.
Mm-hmm. Sure.
Well, this is not necessarily on your topic, but it's just, free kills me. Free just kills me. I feel like, just, you know, you would never think, I don't know if there's anybody who would ever think, let's go for free to the movies. You know, we don't do that. So why we have to take on the sense that free among us is okay, it makes me nuts. And it does affect this audience thing, because, and I know I'm middle class, and I can think about paying for things, but most of my audience is at least middle class currently, and can think about paying things. And yet, I have a big struggle with people about trying to get them to pay something like a full price. I know this is probably a thing for marketing people that makes you crazy too, but also even, like we do lots of events at the theater and try to invite people to come and do other things and try to do this engagement. And I was walking behind a couple the other day, heading towards the room where we were going to do this other thing. And they said, in all earnestness, turning to them, should we go? I'm not sure. I hear they have free cheese. And so they went.
It's a great motivator right there.
Early bird special.
Yeah.
Free cheese. Notice the tray of cookies against the wall.
That was for you.
I think what John said about free is very profound, and I think that it's interesting to talk about giving students letting students in for free. The question is, does that encourage theater going, or does that encourage just seeing things for free? So that's a good conversation. But I'm also interested in is the experiment that the larger theaters are doing, and I think Roundabout is the only one represented here, of the $25 ticket for the new play.
I'm not under that.
No, I'm talking about, I know that. What I'm saying is the larger theaters, which normally whatever, are doing $25 tickets for just for the new place, either way down in the basement, or in the case of Lincoln Center, way up on the roof. But nonetheless, I have done that. I love it. I love spending $25. I love going to see for spending $25. And if I didn't have to spend online, which I've done many times.
Our public lab tickets are
$20. No, I've done that too. But then, no, like, yeah. I'm home. I still have mine twice, and I'm still in the middle. But anyway, my point is, I wonder if, and again, I'm talking about at the large theaters. I know the smaller theaters are free. But I wonder what that experiment, what has been learned, or what is being learned from the experiment of doing the new plays, sometimes the riskier new plays, in the smaller space with the lower ticket price.
And I can say, it sounds like incredibly nerdy marketing talk, but I think it's important to say this.
Price nerdy marketing talk is part of this conversation.
Price is not motivating. It's an anti-inhibitor. I mean, if somebody wants to go see a show, the price might determine whether they can afford to go or not. Mm-hmm. But having a free ticket or a cheap ticket doesn't make someone want to go to the show. Mm-hmm. And secondarily, you know, I would say, to back this up with data, that the audience for our shows in the Underground, for example, does not inherently look tremendously different from our audience in our other stages. It's not like by offering a lower price ticket, you're automatically changing the demographic makeup of our audience. The outreach that we have the opportunity to do when we have that ticket price just looks very different. Yeah. It doesn't necessarily mean that the people who are attracted to that show looks tremendously different. We just have to strategically, and we have to look at our strategy and how we communicate the presence of that show very differently. It doesn't just happen because the price is low. Otherwise, it looks exactly the same as it does upstairs in 7 feet.
I asked a final question, or anybody who has a small theater where they charge less for tickets, how do your marketing budgets in there?
Oh, they're minuscule.
For the small spaces relative to the large spaces.
Ours are minuscule across the board compared to the show budget. But I mean, yeah. I mean, we actually try very hard not to market the public lab shows really any differently than we market the bigger shows. We give them the same amount of attention, sometimes much more. Yeah. We do the same amount of effort. And I just want to emphasize, it's not that I don't want diverse audiences. I just don't want to have to sort of dress a house in a way that's not going to be...
That's not authentic.
Yeah. That's not authentic. And so, and for us, part of being the public theater and what we really strive to do is we hold back tickets for every show, including Fun Home, the rush tickets. Like, we specifically hold back tickets to be rush tickets, knowing that the show is sold out, and sell them for $20 a day of. So, we specifically try hard to always let someone have access some way, somehow, through all of our shows. So, it's a driving factor with us.
I want to share something that we heard in Washington from a playwright to speak to your point, John, that one of the most effective things for her in an interaction with a theater where she had worked was that they actually gave her X number of tickets to give away to people she selected. It's kind of another, it wasn't Wooly where they curate ahead of time, but the people she selected, so she had like 10 or 15 comps, then those people, because those people then went out and said, this was really cool and I really liked it, and their friends bought tickets. So I'm just curious whether other people have experimented with targeted, which is different than what you're talking about, which is devaluing the equation, right? But actually, because
we've actually done it in Two River. We had this big project that we call Project Dream Takeover, and we identified towns that didn't have the right representation at the theater, we thought, and we gave everybody in the town free tickets.
Right.
And made a big party on that night, and they all came. And we tried to keep selling them up.
And are they coming back, do you think?
Some.
Yeah.
And we actually do it with artists, too. They go and are in the shops and restaurants in the town, and we give them these vouchers to go. And if you made a friend at Rite Aid, please get her to come and see your show.
Yeah, that's cool.
Oh, that's interesting.
Yeah.
We've done it. It's a little harder. I've mastered how we sort of get the follow-through to happen. It's a little awkward, Can you make sure there's people, spread the word that they like your play?
Well, you're taking a risk that they like it.
Yeah, that's right. Formalizing it is awkward.
Mm-hmm.
But we supply those awkward. authors.
Well, and I think this play, I think this playwright's point was she was only going to invite people who were going to like it. Because she
and
knew.
She thinks are going to like
well, but right, but it was her, well, that she thought was a pretty good guess. You're right. And obviously they were going to tell her that they did. But, you know, but that there's a certain amount which is different than just papering. Mm-hmm. Right? Yeah, Christian?
It's really a question. I don't have the answer to it, but there's some underlying assumptions that we're making, I think, on the theater, on the producing side about audience behavior relative to spending and how we value the work in order to get people there that ignore the fact that the same people that we think we want, or that we say that we want, whether or not they are wealthy or middle class, or even in some cases lower middle class, probably, spend the same amount or more on other forms of entertainment, easily. Whether it be dining out, whether it be going to movies more often, whether it be going to sporting events, whether it be going to live music, the same people who will balk at a $50 ticket or a $75 ticket to a play don't balk at any of those other things, and probably cumulatively over the course of the year, I've had a good study, spend way more that we think they can spend or are willing to spend. We tend to feel a little bit of embarrassment about asking them to spend money on what we're doing. I mean, that, and I wonder if we're not devaluing our own work ourselves a little bit somehow in trying to strategize how to get people to spend money on it. There's some fundamental questions I have about our own relationship to the work, and I'm not actually sure what I'm asking, actually.
Jeremy and Mandy both seem to have a...
Well, I've been sitting here thinking about sort of the intersection of just that and sort of where we started and where we've come in the conversation. And it's that, you know, artistically, aesthetically, right, everyone here, I think, probably believes he, she, they, their institution is taking enormous risks, right? I mean, that's... I think anyone who's good at their job in New York, whatever defines... you know, what your theater does, if you're at the top of your game and you're doing it well, you are taking risk. But actually, some of us have become really expert in covering up just how risky those risks are in order to behave like the film industry and sell a lot of tickets and entice people to come see the extraordinary risk. And I guess part of what I've been thinking about is, like, are we meant to be lifting the veil on our risk-taking, or should we be doing an even better job? You know, the 12 Years a Slave story is hilarious. Why? Because 12 Years a Slave got made when Brad Pitt signed on to be the executive producer,
yeah, sure.
And in it, I met with the writer. I know that that's how that film got greenlit. And in Germany, where they launched the film, they launched it with big billboards with Brad Pitt's face all over it. This is a matter of public record. And a huge controversy broke out because how can you sell that film on Brad Pitt? That's crazy. And they had to revamp everything and then behave more, responsibly. I fill in the blank, whatever, But they had to sort of expose their risk a little bit more and stop, and let it show a little bit more that they made this incredibly difficult, very, very dark piece of extraordinary cinema. And hope people come, because, that's what we're in the Brad Pitt's in it, actually.
Mm-hmm.
And so it really is actually this, it feels like we've been having a conversation about that inherent contradiction, right? We take enormous risks. Pay attention to us, but ignore that we take risks. Actually behave when you go to the box office like we're not taking any risk at all. And I think that that's a kind of weird contradiction that, may be unique to our industry. I don't think film executives...
The smaller theaters actually embrace what you just said. They do. I mean, I don't know. And New York is a different part of what they're selling is the fact that, we're doing this crazy ambitious thing with these new artists, and that's why you should come and buy a ticket. And that's a very different aesthetic from saying...
But there's a different habituation, which is if you wanted to do something not crazy for some reason, you would be outside the comfort zone of what your audience is used to it here. I mean, I think some of this is a conversation about comfort zones.
Mm-hmm.
And it's interesting because this has come up... I mean, part of what you guys are talking about, I think, is how better do we communicate to the audience what this experience is. Mm-hmm. And that's what the veil's about. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. The thing that kills me year after year is I think we tend to do, I think we do a very good job, the playwrights, of communicating what we do and our mission, and I think we can always do better. I think we can do better as a community at communicating our mission to audiences and thereby managing expectations to some extent. But, you know, I think that if you purchase a subscription or even a flex pass to Playwrights Horizons, or even if you purchase a membership, a young membership, which is $20 to $520 per play, you sort of know what you're getting into, you know? And Mr. Burns' example that Carol gave is a very good one because, you know, there were subscribers who were gaga and loved it, but you would read those House Manager reports and you'd see those walkout rates. And it was astonishing and sad to some extent because, I mean, no matter how much you tell people that you're about risk, you're about discovery, reward, whatever those buzzwords are that you want to use, there are still going to be people out there who, I don't like what you do. I didn't like this show, therefore I'm not coming back. In other words, I bought into your mission, but you still let me down. Well, what is our mission if not to challenge you to redefine your expectations of risk and new? And it's confounding. And I think Carol and I said, you know, year after year, we think, how do we manage that expectation a little better?
Do you engage Tim in that conversation?
Absolutely.
Okay. Yeah. Jeremy and Todd.
I think Playwrights does a pretty good job of managing that expectation, actually. I'm going to say something because I was called on.
Todd's ready to talk.
Slightly, it's stepping back slightly to what Mandy and Christian were sort of talking about, or combining those two ideas. I think, I knew about the Brad Pitt thing because it was in New York Magazine, right? That's in Steve McQueen's profile. You know, in the back of New York Magazine, they talked about how nobody wanted to make a movie until Brad Pitt decided he wanted to make a movie. And I think it's absolutely right that we hide our decision-making processes and we hide our artists and, you know, God forbid an actor is asked to do a second press avail. I mean, like in a movie, that would just be a joke. I mean, I think there's a certain amount of pulling back the veil on everything that we do and providing more information that is would bring us more in line with other forms of entertainment. And the other thing I would say is, sure, somebody's willing to drop $85 to go see or $150 to go see Beyonce, but they heard Beyonce's the whole album. They've heard everything that she's going to do. They've seen the YouTube videos. There's a lot more access to what that thing is than, you know, New York Theater Workshop is currently providing for Love and Information, where how would you, if you didn't work in the industry, how would you see the script? How would you know, you know, would you, you know anything about the playwright who's unwilling to talk to the press? You know what I mean? There's this, like, a huge amount of difference between the access that, you know, sports, I'm now stealing from Ben Cameron, but that, you know, sports or film or television or any, or media, music, or any other medium is putting out there about what it is that they're offering. So, yeah, they might be willing to spend a little bit more, they might be willing to invest on slightly less information that we perceive we're giving them, but actually they're getting a whole host of information and a whole host of exposure, and their risk is being hedged by having experienced that too.
Yes, you're right, but we tend to act and think, I think, maybe I should speak myself, but like they don't want to spend that money, or that they don't really have it, or that parting with cash for entertainment purposes or cultural enrichment purposes is somehow inherently
sure.
than most people actually perceive it to be, especially in New York. People spend tons of money on that. We don't live in our apartments.
Jeremy, can I follow up with one thing, and it's putting you on the spot a little bit, but when Carol Churchill doesn't want to do interviews, do you go to an actor, a director? I mean, is that, do you think about that?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, and
I mean, I think we went to every actor in fact. We went to the director for sure. We pitched every paper and every outlet, 6 or 7 different ideas. Please, please, please cover the show in a obviously much more veneer of professionalism way.
Veil down.
There's the word I'm looking for. Thank you, Mr. Dignified is not a word that comes
Casey's leaving. But, you know, we had to generate the same or, in this instance, more recognition, and I don't think that we've done it, but, you know, for a piece that is the size that this piece is, right? In addition to being, you know, I think it was Jesse Green wrote, you know, what people are, you know, commenting on chat boards that this is like, you know, a weird play. He was like, you're coming to New York Theater Workshop for a Carol Churchill play. What did you think you were getting? But on top of the content, it's huge, and a huge financial risk on top of whatever aesthetic risk Carol is taking in making that show. And because she's Carol Churchill, she can say to a theater, and does to every theater, it's not just us, I'm not willing to do, you can do my play, but I'm not willing to do Press Avails. It's in my contract.
Well, and that speaks to one of the issues that comes up, which is there are some artists who want to be totally engaged with the money, and there are other artists who want nothing to do with it. And how do we have room for both of those sides, Todd?
Maybe we're going to respond to that, because I'm going to I'm sitting here, this is so fascinating, and I keep getting buffeted by agreeing with everybody, and then but I'm sitting here, maybe it's a stupid or simplistic question, but I keep wondering playwrights just, if playwrights just want a different audience than they're getting in the theater. The theaters and the playwrights just want, you know, which is a question that isn't really about risk per se, and it's not really, you know, and that's what was so weird, because there was so much sort of agreement, there was strange amount of agreement in these studies until you got to those demographic questions, mm-hmm. things in these studies. And I think, you know, it's that thing that theaters know that maybe the least risk averse people are the oversubscribers, mm-hmm. the theater lovers. Mm-hmm. Playwrights are not writing for them. Those are not the, that I wonder if those perceptions of demographics aren't wishes.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
You
know,
really,
that I want a more diverse, I want a lower economic strata audience. Not, you know, I think my play, even my plays appeal to them, but that's mm-hmm. what I want to see in the theater of my generation, of my moment, of my life. And so that
we want it too, though. Don't we want it too?
Well, I don't know, John. I mean, yes.
Yes.
But you want the audience also that will support your theater.
I have the one that will. I have the one that will. I'm happy about film.
Right.
But it's not that I don't also want younger and more diverse audiences. My playwrights should too. I want that with
them. But I wonder if it's the same kind of want. Okay, so, you know, you want to diversify your own. Do you want to keep the good, you know? I'm not sure, but I'm imagining being a playwright. I mean, I keep thinking about this Douglas Turner Award piece from the 1960s about wanting a sufficient audience of other Negroes so I can also explain myself, you know, to everybody. It's kind of what Tisa was talking about, too, nuance and understanding of it, you know? And I think if playwrights tend to actually, you know, if they're still in the field, they tend to be a little younger than the theaters that are still in the field, but the same length of time, you know. Mm-hmm. And I think they imagine, maybe, I don't know, I'd love to hear you guys talk about it, but they imagine talking to different people than the ones they see in your theater. You want those other people too, but this is where it's like Liz saying, you know, maybe I don't have as much at stake, but you absolutely have everything at stake. Mm-hmm. I want an audience with everything in me, but I don't live or die by that, or the theater does live or die by that.
So can we do something very unscientific, but actually ask the playwrights in the room to respond to that?
Wow. I think it really depends on the theater company that you're working with. Because I do know, you know, you're not going into a theater company with no idea of who their audience is, you know, and you kind of know, okay, this theater company, this is the audience, this company, this is the audience, and so, you know, for me, if I were to be working with a theater company, I wouldn't go into a theater company and say, oh no, I'm going to work with you, but please change your audience. I'm not going to do that. So I'm not sure if that answers the question. Maybe what I should do, and what I have been doing, is to select the theater companies with whom I want to work with, because I do appreciate that audiences. You know.
Mm-hmm. Liz?
Well, a couple of thoughts come to mind. One is that a couple of years ago, I had a meeting in San Francisco, a magic theater meeting, but it was at the Jewish Cultural Center. And so about half the audience were you know, theater people and friends of mine, younger people. And a full half of the audience were elderly Jewish ladies. And in the discussion afterwards, they were spectacular. I mean, they, you know, I asked sort of an open-ended, I was curious to see what was coming through. It was a historical play, but you know, it was reflecting things that are going. And they jumped right in on the politics. And it got so heated that one woman stormed out. She made a dramatic exit and slammed the door, and everybody was shouting. It was really. I took my elderly mother to see Trojan Barbie in Cambridge by Christine Evans, and she loved it. And Christine Evans was very pleased to hear. I mean, it's not about age. At the same time. A new play of mine was just selected by a group of grad students at UMass who've just gotten the funding to start a new play this first year. So I'm so excited with the youngs, you know? The youngs are digging my work, you know? So I don't know. I mean, of course you don't want it to be all, you know, elderly wealthy white people. I love them too. But you don't want to be only them. And not only because you feel like, you know, you're really connecting on all possible levels. You want diversity of audience because you want to have a broader conversation. But also, you know, for a sense of, am I engaged in something that matters to the culture? We understand as theater people that we're on the, you know, we're in a niche area of the culture. You know, we're not part of the mainstream necessarily. So that's cool, you know, we're cool with that. Nevertheless, you know, even within those terms, you know, is there a sense that there's a you know, an exciting bigger conversation that we're a part of, and not just that it's a cultural marker of a certain class of person that goes to the theater because that's the kind of thing that they do, not because they're really excited about the play. That makes sense.
Well, I'm coming at this from a marketer's perspective. I think what artists and often we are looking at is attracting a sensibility or attracting a psychographic profile, whatever you want to call it, of a type of person who will benefit from hearing that story. Mm-hmm. And if it doesn't fall along demographic lines, mm-hmm. people get often very frustrated when we don't necessarily see the kind of outreach going on that is focused on that attitude or that mm-hmm. idea, not so much the profile of what these people in the theater look like. I mean, I think we're at an interesting crossroads now as marketers in the 21st century with the tools that are out there for us, whether it's social media, whether it's online marketing, you know, all different platforms and shapes, to target people based on what you know they do and see and believe in, as opposed to, you know, sending your money off to the New York Times and praying. You know, it's a very different mentality now, because the granularity with which we can target people, and it's perhaps creepy to some, but tremendously advantageous when you're trying to get at a very specific idea. Mm-hmm. So I think it's a really exciting time to be able to really get at the heart of what we're trying to do. Yeah. We've only relied on demographics because that's what's worked in the past to sort of find that niche or find that cross-section of the market, but now we don't have to rely on just on demographics. Mm-hmm. It's an exciting time. Mm-hmm.
I think from an artist and an artist advocate perspective, I think about this a lot in terms of aspiration. In terms of artist aspiration and the idea of moving up. And I think that, you know, when we founded our theater, it was very much about the new launching pad, and somewhere along the line, we realized that actually we had the right audience for a lot of these plays, because we saw them go forward to other places where they were received differently, contextually, even the same play, when they were with our audience and when they were with other audiences or in a different context. And so...
And you heard that from the writers?
Yeah.
Or you heard that, yeah.
And the writers and from sitting in the house.
Right.
So, and so is there... Something, I mean, certainly there's a way that we talk differently about the work in terms of where it wants to go or where the artist wants to go. And I think in terms of the choices the artist is making, the in itselfness of working with us is different from this aspirational thing. And to me, that becomes a great divide when we're sending artists out into the world, and also in terms of who is interested in the kind of work we do or what sort of the thing in itself becomes. If that makes sense.
One of the things, Tisa, sorry.
I just wanted to clarify a little bit. I'm sort of hearing that throughout the afternoon that there's a perception that audiences of color might need special accommodations or price discounts. And I think that all of the theaters here, and there's some really large ones, and I've seen everything at MTC, Andy, because of Phototronics. And I don't think Snow Geese is really that risk-taking. I think it's there. However, I can see why you might think so. Mm-hmm. You know, going back to my point is, for instance, Pan Asian. Our audiences are really quite diverse. It's, Asian Americans also fairly affluent. I mean, so our discounts are best for the students. We have school matinees at $12 or something, and of course. Immigrant groups are something else. That is something very, very different ball of wax. But I was just sort of hearing all of this. I would think that all of the theaters here, no matter what your mission or your theme and your content is, you want to have as many diverse or different audiences. Audiences that would really appreciate your work, that understands the work. So I think that in a way, the large theaters are getting kind of a bad rap also, because there's a lot of stereotypical thinking of who reach or focus on. And I don't think that really is so. So this thing about the risk is really sort of within the theater's own definition.
Yeah. Yeah.
And did I make a point about about diverse audiences? I don't think it's necessarily that we need to give them any particularly special accommodations. It is true on Broadway that some of the black plays with black themes, African-American themes, they do tend to attract a lot of the ladies, church ladies, who are coming on busloads. But I think that's also a kind of different template of what we're talking about. But I would like to think that all the theaters here are very interested in just embracing people who would appreciate the work.
Well, and I
you work at Club Fun.
I think, Tisa, you just said something really important in the thing, and it's the same thing I think that Mandy's saying, which is that when we think about risk for every organization, risk has a different connotation. And one of the things that I wonder whether it's helpful to share with audiences, as you're talking about your plays, is what's risky for you. And that's the thing. And one of the things we haven't talked about that's in Alan's piece that we both responded to was this idea that, and it's what Howard Schawitz at Woolley talks a lot about, that if my audience is here and I want to get them there, proximate learning means you go one step at a time. And how you, and I thought that was also interesting, and I don't know whether that resonated with anyone else, but this idea that you shape them and move them along, is there a continuum along which you can move people? And what happens when the beginning point of that continuum is I'm not in the theater at all, right? And how do you even get them onto the continuum that then keeps them moving farther and farther? And I'm interested, yeah.
Well, I'm really intrigued by this thing that you're speaking about, going from the risk aversion over to the co-creation, that there's this spectrum that people are traveling along, because I think of that as a New York problem, that so many of the people who come to the work are makers of theater or in the industry in some way. I think of that as our problem. I'd be really interested to see if that statistic holds as you do this deeper study of audiences. How many people did theater when they were in college, or they did it in high school, so that they have an affinity, they feel an affinity to theater differently, and that's the reason that they come. I'm really curious about that. It also holds to, I worked with the NEA, they did a series of comedians, I'm sure you guys have looked at the study, about how art works and how you get people integrated, in how it integrates into their lives. And there's a similar thing in the chart that we came to that was about how many people are, they make art, and that's the way that they as a hobbyist,
right,
or as a professional.
Which circles back to the pro-am thing,
yes,
right, also,
exactly,
about how much in the theater do we
about
encourage
that,
that.
So I'm really interested to see how that holds to our industry, mm-hmm, as how we fit in, how is that truly how we fit into community? Mm-hmm.
Well, one of the things that was interesting to me in Alan's piece was that, at least in the theaters where he was looking at, South Coast and Steppenwolf, was that they had a number of people who were engaged as theater makers themselves. They were, you know, mm-hmm, acting in community theaters, or maybe they were theater students. They were, like, studying that or something at some point along the way. That did not make them more predisposed to risk. What made them predisposed to risk-taking was if you were intellectually engaged, mm-hmm, in some way. So that was that. I was not what I would have guessed at all. Mm-hmm. I would have guessed if you were making theater, then you... But, you know, maybe it makes sense. If you're in your community theater and you do lots of, you know, standard musicals, that's your taste, right? Probably. So maybe you're not so into, like, taking the risk. But if you're intellectually engaged and you're reading everything and you're blogging, then you are. So just, like, who's already... you know, what that proximate learning thing, who's further out along the way?
Mm-hmm. Christian and then Eric.
I'm really interested in the same question, but I'm also interested in it from the institutional side, especially in terms of the proximate learning, getting people on a continuum, the implications for that, potentially, particularly for institutions that have a large infrastructure, in the short term, at the very least, if you are actually trying, if your goal is actually to transform your audience, if you're not in the act of, if your audience isn't stable, if you just have decided, or you need to change your audience, it does seem to be the implication of that trajectory is potentially short term restructuring or shrinking of an organization, and the amount of work that it might be able to do. Not necessarily for that, I mean, but potentially for long-term gain. Mm-hmm. But it seems to me that the implication of risk, if you want to think about it that way, is that you might have to look at it and say, well, yeah, actually, this is going to be a financial risk. And it might not pay off right away. But actually, if you're going to do the thing where you're leading with content, mm-hmm, and you're looking toward the audience you want in 6 years, mm-hmm, 10 years, or 4 years, whatever it is, you may have to look at what the implications for the institution might be and whether some people are actually going to have to.
Or you change your behavior, because, John, in a way, what you are doing with the playwrights is a kind of proximate learning, right? I mean, you're saying to your audience, I'm going to introduce you to this next piece of the equation. It's not just, I mean, I hadn't really thought of that before, but and so, or maybe there's an intentionality of, if you at least articulate where you want to go.
Yeah. Yeah, maybe you don't have to shrink it, you have to change a modus operandi. There are potentially structural changes that these organizations, which are not, especially the large ones, are not necessarily so nimble, you know, mm-hmm, may have to make in order to accommodate those goals, but it does seem to speak to priorities and, mm-hmm, sort of actually saying what do you want.
Eric, you had a thought?
Yeah, the point that makes me sad a little bit is that I feel like, I'd be curious to see the other large computers to respond to this, is that I feel like a lot of times we spend a lot of our time catering to the younger set by setting low prices that are removing the barrier of price for them, as well as catering to the older set that has the time to go to the theater. So what you're doing is you're focusing a lot of times on two ends of the spectrum while you're missing what's in the middle, but that's not the theater's fault all the time. I feel like, as Tom and I were just talking, a lot of times, once people hit 30, they do kind of, their life, they go into this transitional phase in their life. I mean, I'm in my 40s, I have a small child in my life, I don't go to the theater nearly as much as I used to, and that's really the case for a lot of my peers. But I know that, you know, once my child grows up, I will probably start going to the theater again. And, you know, Carol and I have talked a lot about packages and how do you manipulate packages so that you can accommodate the people who do have the time to go to the theater all the time and the people who may just want to pick and choose. So as a result, Playwrights Arise has wound up with several different kinds of packages to accommodate those people, and I think that's right. Mm-hmm. I think that's
well, because
right.
Those people are the number one, the largest audience group on Broadway is 42 to 52. But we're not, they're not being asked.
Well, why is that?
Probably because they're only being asked to go once or twice.
That's it.
Maybe.
Or they're from out of town, they're spending their vacation.
What are they choosing to see?
Correct.
The type of direction they're choosing to see. If the theory holds that the time of life of children and all that can be gone, there's a whole other sort of set of factors.
Right.
And in those instances, they're going with their kids too.
I mean, they don't slice and dice it that way. I just think.
That's what I think we need to figure out. I don't have the answer to this, and I'm just saying that I think there is a drop-off period. But then they come back, and it's bridging that gap and creating that continuum. So, as you're saying, so that once we start them out at one point, because I really think if we get those people to theater, they will be less risk-averse than the people further down the line.
I mean, one of the things we're hearing that is an unintended or an unanticipated thing as we're having these conversations is it's the real difference in possibilities between I'm maintaining a base of subscribers or whatever, and my organization is constantly, as you say, it's all single ticket buyers because it's all different. And where's, I think something that it will be a focus of some of the questions this summer is where's the drill down or sweet spot of how do we accommodate both? And how do some of the places that have relied on that person who comes five times during the year, how do we switch that so that you actually are able to accomplish more with two? And then what's the role of the artists or the playwrights or the directors? Because in fact, we can't afford to aggressively advertise each and every one. So if you have to get repeat people, this isn't a formed thought, but how can the artists help get those people in, and do you create a fan, you know, is there a way if you work with someone 1 year and then you work with them 3 years later to make sure that those people are coming back? Are they with you and then they're with you and then, right, how do you share that is a thought. And the other thing that we've heard a lot about that I'm curious about is time, right? That when do you first intersect, because you talk about, that's why I asked 3 years out, right? Some of the most successful kind of intersections, I think, between artists and the places they work are when there's a lot of time as opposed to the everybody arrives 2 days before the first rehearsal and then you're just jumping in and it's, oh yeah, I should meet the, oh yeah, you should, right? And there isn't, so I'm curious, you know, some of you, I mean, Christian, when do you guys first talk to a playwright, if you're talking to them,
about
the work?
Mm-hmm. Or just editing?
No, about audiences, or if you do, or marketing, or when do you pull the marketing?
That depends on when the season actually occurred.
Right.
But sometimes that's a year in advance. Sometimes it's a year and a half in advance. I mean, we have a couple of projects that we are committed to for next year that aren't going to happen until late next year.
Right.
And so all of those conversations are actually happening now.
Happening
there are
now.
Also examples of things that get slammed into a season, and there's 2 months turnaround. All of a sudden, there's nothing to do but just get it up there. If there's not there is a system.
Right.
Ideally, though, we'd like it when we're doing all that.
Right. Tom?
I've only heard about that last minute slide in the show. Never really experienced it.
Nor has Jeremy.
but I want to point out, I think that the mentality is shifting, because, or at least for us, if we can just run this here. You know, the time at which we engage an artist or playwright or director to start talking about marketing has typically been an advertising, which doesn't start until 2 months run. Whereas now we're starting to think of it on a much longer span of time. And so the minute that they're in the mix and we've announced them, we're engaging our fans with social media about the content of the show. We're having a long-term conversation as opposed to just thinking about it. So that we're definitely shifting our thinking.
We're doing this thing that we've totally stolen that a lot of people are doing about this audience engagement thing, trying to, and I many places talked about this, about this notion of finding merging of marketing and artistic, that you have this other force that is being called audience engagement and community engagement. And we've done that, so we've tried to systematize around every single play that we do these events, we call them side tutor, which is these set of 10 to 12 events that involve the artists mm-hmm. and others in some way. There are these other events leading up to and around.
And when do they start?
Well, we just started.
No, but I mean, it,
with but yeah, but you know, as soon as we can, we, depending on, you know, we try to have as many kooky different ideas to get at different sectors of possible people. So, you know, we'll be doing stuff at the beach this summer, mm-hmm. throughout the year next year, because that's the time to do that at the beach. You know, so
other thing, the beach is a big part of a lot of your stuff.
A big idea.
One of the things that was fascinating to me in Zani's piece was in something like 80%+ of the playwrights that she surveyed, and some of them were some pretty well known playwrights too, were saying that they wanted to have a direct access to the audience, a direct sort of exchange with the audience. And I don't know that they're all wanting to like be in the talk back session where the audience tells you how to rewrite the second act. Maybe, maybe not. But I mean, but the 80% plus wanted to be in a direct relationship with the audience in some ways was to me really surprising. And then, how is that made possible, and what does that mean?
Most of that is talk backs, frankly, in most theaters. I wonder what they mean.
Because so many of them say they don't like it, right? So then,
well, right, exactly. Not all talk backs are that terrible, but
no, of
course. But yeah, but I just wonder what that means to individual mm-hmm. players. I'm sure it makes something different to a lot of them. 80%, that's a wild statistic. So
yeah.
What are they talking? What are they talking?
I mean, aren't they talking about like the language that's used to describe their pieces, the way the marketing looks, the kind of pictures, like basically the way in which the perceptions of what their art is going to be is art.
I think it was actually, we can look at it, but I'm pretty sure that it was in really like this way, in real life with the audience.
It's a completely different thing from being in New York. And I can understand New Yorkers not understanding maybe the same thing. I would be obnoxious.
I'm going to call Shannon out too, because she was in Florida.
But it's fascinating, because and there are things to do in other places that maybe we could do in New York. But, I mean, the Duke is actually, we can talk again about something. But the Duke is funding this thing for us wonderfully, fantastically now. I met this playwright who I didn't know. She kept doing some readings in this festival that we do, a woman called Tanya Saracho, who's this amazing writer. And I just got to this place where I just kept loving her plays, and we do them in front of our audience in these readings and festivals, and I could see it was going to be a hard sell. And so I sat down with her and I said, I want to do your work. What can we do? And we concocted this idea that she would come and be in residence in Red Bank. And she, because she does these things with women's groups that she's done in Chicago for a long time, we figured she'd do that in Red Bank, and she'd meet women's groups and children's groups, and she'd go into workshops with them, and writing workshops, and spend the course of a whole year getting to know our audience, yep. and then write a play knowing our audience. That mm-hmm. I feel like then I could produce her play because it's going to speak to our audience in that way. But it also does all kinds of community engagement stuff for us. It gets at new audiences. But she really wants to do that. Yep. She's excited and thrilled. Yeah, and they want to, I think, I don't know, writers. I think I'm noticing people who want to be there.
Mm-hmm.
These writers want to come to this place. Partly we give them nice apartments and we feed them, and they go to the beach and stuff.
Apparently, you buy the beach.
But they want to.
She cooks.
Shannon?
I mean, yeah, my perspective on that is.
You should let people know where you were.
So I was the executive director of the Orlando Shakespeare Theater for. I was the director of development for 3 years, executive director for 2 years. And there, it is a different thing. It's not, I don't know how to describe it exactly, except to say that someone was talking earlier about making the playwrights the celebrities. We at our theater interacted with audiences in such a way that everyone was a celebrity who was involved in the show, like mm-hmm. our props master and our costumers mm-hmm. and our favorite thing to do is give people access to the costume shop and to tell people it took 6,000 man hours to mount this show and give people like really pull down the veil of like, here's what we're doing back in the secret corner, don't look behind the curtain, we're just doing this production. But it was more about that sense of interaction, which wasn't so much like a curated discussion or we're going to educate you somehow. It was more about like, hey, meet these people. You guys would really like each other because they build funky prop things and you love seeing the funky prop things on the stage. And it was more about wine and free cheese yeah. and conversation, but not really a purpose-driven, we're here to educate you kind of mm-hmm. thing. It was more about, this is who the people are, not just the playwrights, not just the producers, not just, you know, the people on stage who are very, very important and obviously get a much bigger reaction, but also who are the people that in the building and in the community, you know, who is that costume designer that's working with four different theaters at the same time? And, you know, that is really interesting. People mm-hmm. who love theater, people who love the craft of the art, those are the people that people never would get a chance to meet right. unless we put them in a room together with the audience. And that seemed to be really effective for us in creating loyal people who understood and wanted to come back, and not only to our theater, but to other theaters in the community.
Mm-hmm. Right, mm-hmm. right. Okay, Todd? Mm.
Yeah, no, that's great to hear. I mean, I feel it in my own life that I'm always surprised, I don't know, I take for granted that people who are not in this world that we live in just automatically know.
Yeah.
And they don't.
They have no idea.
And it seems special and it seems magical.
And even in New York, I'm sure.
Oh, they don't know.
Yeah.
What it
takes. And the other thing about, this is, I guess, about your point, John, about the, about Tanya. You know, I just started to think it's such, we live in a time, a theater of, really, it's an aberration. We've never had a moment in history like the last 30 or 40 years in the American theater where playwrights don't write for their community, don't mm. know who the audience is going to be.
Mm.
Theater has always been made locally. And mm. so, it's like, how do you get back to that when the writer usually doesn't even know where the play's going to be produced? Or if they do, they haven't written it for the theater that it's going to be produced at. So I do think all those things you're talking about, they're almost foundational.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Well,
I mean,
and if
it's
you
really
took
accidental for me, it's not noble. I love her plays, and we would do them, and I could see the audience just not quite. And I was like, I get it, I get it. But they weren't quite. And I thought, if she got who these people were a little bit more, I know she could write for them.
Well, this is, I mean, it's interesting too. I'd love to hear Lou talk about this too. It's like, you know, you never see Chicano plays in New York.
Yeah.
You know, we have, you know, years of Cuban plays, years of Puerto Rican plays, increasingly Dominican, you know what I mean? But you never, in L.A.,
yeah.
you don't see Puerto Rican plays.
Yeah.
You know, it's all Chicano.
So why is that, do you think?
Well, I think, I mean, for Intar, when I first took over 4 years ago, I was approached by somebody, and they said to me, so are you going to make it a Cuban theater again? And not being Cuban, that was totally awesome. Why would I do that? And A, and B, what do you mean? And I think Intar, like every theater, and has nothing to do with our cultural background, is sort of the sieve of whatever the political story is of the day, right?
Right.
We respond to our world around us. And so Intar, having a focused mission, I think was specific in the sense that it's Latino-based, went with the immigration flow. So when you look at the beginnings of Intar, it was Puerto Rican and Cuban, and then Dominican when I first came to Intar in the late 80s and 90s, very Dominican-based, and then we started to see the Mexican population coming in, and then the Ecuadorians and Colombians. You know, it just changed, it just grew. And I think that is why Chicano has sort of said away. The Mexicans went that way and they began the Chicano theater on that side. Yeah. Cross pollination didn't really happen. You know, obviously, this is not the first thing.
No, it's crazy.
Next year.
Well, we're in Chicago next week, maybe we'll say
Louise,
something.
You know, there's so many people. Time hasn't yet been in
Chicago. Oh, that's a great story.
Oh,
it's
great. It's
great. Just going back, you know, I have the dubious luxury of not actually having an audience, which is kind of nice. so I get to run by the seat of my pants.
Right.
I really do get to fly by the hip. And when I say I don't have an audience, I mean, I don't have to, I have not had to really think that far. I do have a small house, small
right.
theater. My audience, for me, and by choice as an artistic leader, is going to always be, my personal audience is always going to be my audience.
Mm-hmm.
So my risk taking is always in response to how are my artists going to respond, and that's
mm-hmm.
where my big risks,
mm-hmm.
I think,
mm-hmm.
should be. I'm doing plays. You know, the big risk for Intar would be, you know, producing that on rap. I would get
right.
hung.
Right, right.
But what I've done, because I also think that we need to break through the echo chamber of Latino theater, I do look for access to writers such as Adam. I've sort of created another program to cross-pollinate with other theaters so that we can bring in non-Latinos to work on our stage. And that is what's transforming my audience. By not by targeting my ticket buyers, but by targeting artists that are not within that mission, that are not normally on my I hate to use pipeline today. We don't know what that word means. But they're not usually on my radar. By targeting audiences, artists, and bringing them in to work on my stage, and forcing them to then work with my artists, that cross-pollination has brought in their audiences into my theater. And they are now hyped. And like, oh, what's going on there? And that's what's worked for me. So the risk is taking in artists that are not in my mission.
Right.
And trusting that that will be fruitful.
To work with the artists that
to
are.
To work with your audience on my stage.
Right. Okay.
I think we're at a logical place, unless anyone has anything else they want to talk about. We promised we'd be done by 4:15, 4:30, so. If you think of other things, I mean, the real question is, what do you want to know? And we've teased out some good stuff about the training stuff. There's a lot of stuff about that I think we've heard about other things to ask audiences, but this is an ongoing conversation, and we'll be back to you when we're ready to survey those of you who have theaters and some of you who don't, so that we can keep at it. Are we live yet on the website? You want to explain that then?
I've on TDF Stages, which is our online magazine, I've created a special story on the magazine, but it's really just for people who are participating in this conversation, and we will send you the link to that story, but really it's just there so you can comment
and
talk to each other. There's
other things you read or other stuff, right?
We've created a forum where you can leave comments for each other, and if you want, you can send me things that I can put on there as well, like you should check this link out, go to this resource. So it's an online forum where we can continue to talk, basically.
Can I ask one thing? We talked about this early on. Somebody used the word, I think it was Christian, the monolith of the understanding of the audience that gets reflected in those statistics and studies. I wonder if there's a way of breaking down the monolith without sort of dismissing, say, the provocative nature of what was being said, but just to understand a little bit more what the monolith is. I think it would be really helpful.
And I think it's come up a couple of times in conversations about in San Francisco, there was a lot of interest in talking about how as artists, you can make theater cooler and sexier, and this realization that there's a monolith when we say theater, there's a monolith when we say audience, that we have all these monoliths, and we're not really, you know, and that in that it's now a couple of times running, the only thing that's essentially the same is the liveness, right? Mm-hmm. And so I think getting underneath that is important. I'm not sure how we're going to do that, but that's important. Yeah. Thank you.
Maybe just a little bit of where this is going, since this was a lot of, we heard afterwards from in San Francisco that, where is all this going? So we continue on, actually just in the next couple of weeks, we're going to Chicago and then to Minneapolis.
Because why not go there in early March?
Because it's, well, better than early January, I guess. But anyway, so we continue these conversations through the six cities that we were looking at. As Tori was saying, we will be commissioning some new surveying that we, you know, hopefully some of you will be involved in the fall. We'll wrap this up. We'll look at, you will compile and others will compile all these conversations, and we will gather in Boston in November or December to kind of consider what we've learned so far and pull all of that together into a written report, at least, that would be made available to the field. So this will be ongoing, and it might live on further than that. We'll let you know as that goes. But this is these conversations, you know, Mark has been writing, and we've been taking this down. They don't just go up into the atmosphere, but we are moving
Thank
forward
you
with it.
A lot.
Thank
it's
you.
Been really helpful. Thank you.
Thank you
very much.